is by a concerted effort celebrating this week-long program. Today is the concluding session of our week-long activity, and we have assembled virtually to announce the winners of the quiz and essay competition. And also, the most interesting part will be hearing from our students through our student seminar. I, Dr. Manushi Basu, Department of Chemistry, also a member of the Swachhata Action Plan Committee, am moderating the session. Before we proceed to the further activity, I will request our SAP committee coordinator, Dr. Madhumita Roy, to give her welcome address. Madhumita.
A very good afternoon to everybody present in this program. I welcome everybody. Actually, our college has been part of the SAP committee or formed the SAP committee since last year, and we have been working in different fields like energy, greenery, sanitation, hygiene, and waste management and water management as a whole. This SAP committee has been formed under MGNCRE, Ministry of Higher Education, Government of India. And as a part of this program, we are actually in this pandemic situation, we are trying our level best so that we can achieve as many as goals according to the norms of the SAP committee. And we are very happy to announce that we have been selected as Green Champion in North 24 Parganas district this month. And we have been receiving, actually we are going to receive a certificate for that and prize money of about 5,000 rupees. This is a very good news for us. SAP committee comprises of many teachers and non-teaching staffs, as well as students should also be a part of this. But now in this pandemic situation, we are not able to directly involving the students, but in online platforms, we are actually trying to involve or engage the students as much as possible. We are very hopeful for our future. Like if we are able to continue this work in different fields along with the students' participation, then we will be having a great future for our college from all aspects. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Madhumita. Now I request our principal, Dr. Patia Chakraborty, to please give her inaugural address.
You are not audible, madam. Please.
Thank you. All the members of the SAP committee and the NSS team who have been working coordinately to achieve our goal of this Swachhata Action Plan, which is a Green Action Committee. And it is for the, we want our college to be a green part, green tribunal, or whatever we say, the green part. So it is, the other name for it has been given as the Swachhata Action Plan. And it has many norms and many sub-committees under it. So regarding the energy consumption, energy saving, energy conservation, then biodiversity conservation and all other aspects. So that will be discussed later. Now, today I welcome all my students who have been painstakingly participating and doing their part, playing their role in all the four fields which we have organized for this Environment Week. So in this new normal situation for the 1.5 years where we are confined to our home, and we actually don't see each other, but we see each other virtually. So this is really painful for us, the teachers, who do not see our students, who do not face each other, but still we have to work together in tandem and bring our results out. So I hope you all students, you have understood the topic or the week for which we are celebrating. As you know, the environment, this year the topic has been declared by United Nations as decade on ecosystem restoration. It's a decade, so it's a 10-year long program. And what are the main points of this program? Number one is the biodiversity loss, number two the climate change, and number three is pollution. So we have to check all these three and keep these under control through our own means. So each one of us should participate in how we control this situation. Now I think in this pandemic situation, at least we could reduce a bit of pollution, as we are all confined to our homes and we have all participated in increasing the greenery of our surroundings. All students, I hope you have planted plants and trees or whatever you feel like near your home, so that you could contribute to your own society or your neighborhood. So I hope all of you will understand the motto of this program, and I welcome the speakers who are going to represent their department with their own topic as suggested by their teachers, them by their mentors. And thank you, and once again I welcome and congratulate the team for this teamwork. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. It is my privilege to announce the winners of the quiz competition and the essay competition. So at first, I announce the winners of the quiz competition. Will they put their video on when I announce? First in quiz competition is Deepanjan Banerjee from Botany Honors, Semester 4. Two joint winners, second, are from Zoology Honors, second semester, Akash Chandra Patro, and Zoology, second sem honors, Ankita Dotto. And third is from Fisheries, Shatoki Ghosh, from sixth semester, IFL. So will I call them one or it is okay?
Yeah, you do. Let us see who they are.
Yes. So semester 4 Botany Honours, Deepanjan, are you there? Deepanjan Banerjee, semester 4 Botany Honours. Is he there?
I think he hasn't joined, I think. So he may be joining a little later. He's not there, okay. I hope.
Oh, okay. Joint second BSc Zoology, Semester 2, Akash Chandra Patro. Are you there, Akash Chandra? Akash Chandra Patro and Ankita Dotto. They are joint second placeholders. Ankita Dotto, both second sem Zoology Honours. Both are not there. And third is Semester 6, Fishery, Shatoki Ghosh. He's also not there.
Ankita Dotto is there, I found.
Ankita Dotto is there.
Ankita Dotto, please, can you put on your video? Can you please put on your video? Having problem with the video. So, okay, ma'am, I have network issues. Okay. So I've announced the winners. She's saying that she is having network issues. So I proceed to the winner to declare the prizes for the essay competition. First is Srijit Mukherjee, Semester 6 English Honours. Are you there, Srijit Mukherjee? Semester 6 English Honours. He's not there. Again here, two yes. second
Srijit is there.
Winners.
Srijit Mukherjee is there, yes.
So they are actually not willing to put on their videos. Okay, his position has been announced. Srijit, you are first in the essay competition. Semester 6 English Honours and two second place positions are being held by Semester 2 English Honours Diya Boral and Rishin Bhattacharya, Semester 6 Botany Honours. They both are second place holders. Diya Boral, Sem 2 English Honours and Rishin Bhattacharya, Botany Honours. And third winner is Semester 4 BSc General Orpon Maiti, Semester 4 BSc General. The essay, the theme of the essay was Man and Environment. And so the winners have been announced. Now
third,
we
third place is dujon ache na.
Third place is dujon ache. Swastik Chandra, Swastik Chandra English Honours Semester 2. Diya Boral and Swastik Chandra, both are third place holders.
No, Diya, I think the second
place. Orpon Maiti is from fourth sem, BSc General, third place. And Swastik Chandra is Semester 2 English Honours. He is also a third place holder. Again, I repeat the results. It's kind of just come in a sheet. I should have written it out. First is Srijit Mukherjee, Semester 6 English Honours. Two second place holders, Semester 2 English Honours Diya Boral, Semester 6 Botany Honours Rishin Bhattacharya, two third place holders, Orpon Maiti, Semester 4 BSc General, Swastik Chandra, Semester 2 English Honours.
Congratulations
to all our participants.
Yes.
If somebody would have, among the winners would have spoken, at least one representative, then it would have been fine. But nobody is willing to speak out. Only a few, one, two words. Because they are all participants of our World Environmental Day. And we are all kind of trying to contribute in some way to during this pandemic situation. We are in a very challenging condition, and to keep ourselves mentally and physically fit, we are all fighting ourselves. So if from the students somebody spoke about one or two lines, nobody is willing.
Yeah, Manushi, I think most of them are not present here. They were not informed also, I think. So maybe at the end of the program, you may again announce.
Okay.
If someone is there, maybe they'll just speak a few words.
So I go on to the start the technical session with the student seminar. The student seminar, there is a plantation drive which I have to put on. So will I start this present? Will I present that? Okay, I will present the video clip of the plantation drive. Which was you are presenting. Okay, it's fine. Plantation Drive at Home by the NSS unit. Dumita, are you presenting? Okay.
Madhumita, make it full screen.
Sound is not coming actually.
There is no sound.
There is no sound.
Sorry,
the sound could not be heard due to the network.
There is a technical problem. Shall I start it again once more?
You can try.
Okay, I'll be starting again. Please let me know.
You can share the YouTube link in the chat box, I think.
It will be provided.
So we saw the video clip of on plantation drive at home by the made by the prepared by the NSS unit and was compiled by Ruksha Chatterjee of Zoology. Now we proceed on to the technical session where we have the student seminar. The first participant, I invite the first participant, Pritam Ghosh, semester 2 physics honors, to deliver his talk. Pritam Ghosh, please proceed with your
Okay, is it clearly visible and audible?
The slide has still, yeah, it is now come. Yes, it is audible and you're visible. It is visible and you're audible. Yes.
Huh.
Good evening to all my respected teachers and beloved classmates. Hope you all are safe in this pandemic situation. Let's start our discussion. Energy is one of the most important physical aspects of our regular life. According to physics, energy is defined as the ability to do any work. In the era of modern physics, we know several theories of energy, like conservation of energy, energy consumption theory, energy transfer theory, etc. Today we will talk about the energy system of India, the problem related to it, and how to manage these types of issues.
What are cholesterol also?
Here we discuss about the consumption of energy in India. As we know, India is the third highest producer and third highest consumer of energy. From the starting of this decade,
calcium
energy consumption is rapidly increasing year by year. India's total final consumption increased by 50% in the decade from 2007 to 2017, with significant growth across all sectors. Half of the growth came from the industrial sector, which accounted for 42% of total final consumption in 2017, including non-energy consumption. In fiscal year 2015, electric energy consumption in agriculture was recorded as the highest volume, 17.89%. The national electric grid in India has an installed capacity of 382.15 gigawatts as of 31st March 2021. Most of the energy is generated from coal and crude oil. But the problem is that in this era of industrialization and urbanization, and also for population explosion, energy is being used. According to the report of electricity sector, during the fiscal year 2019-20, the gross electricity generated by utilities in India was 1,383.5 kilowatt hour, and the total electricity generation, utilities and non-utilities both, in the country was 1,598 kWh. There was 79.8% share of fossil fuel energy in the country. As a result, the storage of fossil fuel, which had been making for 1,000 years, is decreasing rapidly. This is the point to think. Due to this excessive use of energy, we are facing several problems. Most of these are atmospheric problems like global warming, climate change, etc. A study found that the population weighted particulate matter 2.5 in India for 2012 was at 9 micrograms per cubic meter for particulates coming solely from fossil fuel combustion. According to a new research, air pollution and higher particulate matter 2.5 concentration in ambient air originating from fossil fuel combustion caused 2.5 million premature deaths in India in 2008. India accounts for the world's greatest concentration of coal seam fires. My area suffered from pollution of air, water and land. Coal-based power plants continue to be the major source of air pollution in the country, with over 300 coal thermal power plants still violating emission standards. Besides, coal is the main source of the nation's greenhouse gas emissions, which is the main reason of ozone hole. In 2017, greenhouse gas emissions from electricity sector were 2,194.74 metric tons. Now, the question is that how to prevent it? We have some ways. Some procedures are domestic that we can use individually. All electronic devices like television, fans, lights must be switched off when not in use. We must unplug battery chargers as soon as the battery is fully charged, otherwise it continues to draw energy. It is also important that we replace old devices by energy-sufficient solutions, such as replacing traditional light bulbs by LEDs. But the most important is trying and depending more on renewable energy sources like solar energy, wind energy, tidal waves energy, biomass energy, etc. Government has some legal ways to prevent this energy. Government has 2001 Energy Conservation Act, 2003 Electricity Act, etc. Besides that, government has taken some steps like making efforts to discover and develop the sources of oil in the country. Measures taken to improve the fuel efficiency in the transport and in other industrial sectors for the conservation of energy. Steps have been taken to check the consumption of petroleum, oil and lubricant within manageable limits. Fuel Policy Committee recommended a fair program of substitution of oil by coal in a number of industries. Government is encouraging private sector investment in power generation schemes. Many public sector undertakings and other organizations have been established to improve the energy situation in India. Efforts have been given on the development and utilization of new and renewable sources of energy. A variety of new technologies such as improved chulas, biogas plants, solar voltaic systems, windmills, and small hydro plants have been developed. There are some government-owned power companies like Damodar Valley Corporation, National Thermal Power Corporation, National Hydroelectric Power Corporation, Nuclear Power Corporation of India, Power Grid Corporation of India, etc. As now, renewable power plants, which also include large hydroelectric plants, constitute 37% of India's total installed capacity. To achieve the mission of power for all, development of ultra-mega power projects have been identified as the major thrust area. These projects are a series of ambitious power stations planned by the government of India. This would entail the creation of an additional capacity of at least 1 lakh megawatt by 2022. Now we come to an interesting point. From the perspective of physics, we can think a new idea. We can use acetylene as fuel in the internal combustion engine. As we know, acetylene is a colorless gas produced from the calcium carbide, which is obtained from calcium carbonate. The molecular weight of acetylene is 26 with 2 carbon atoms, while the molecular weight of carbon dioxide is 44 with 1 carbon atom. The amount of carbon dioxide emitted from acetylene is fairly minimal, and other emissions like oxides of nitrogen, oxides of sulfur are highly negligible compared to carbon dioxide. This indicates that acetylene can be relatively more environmentally friendly than other fossil fuels. Two factors have been identified for fuel: diffusion and reactivity. Diffusion of fuel molecules from boundary layer near the cylinder wall into the hot core gas causing partial oxidation of this fuel may be a significant source of burn up of hydrocarbon species, exciting devices during the expansion stroke. Plus, higher molecular weight fuels, which diffuse more slowly, tend to exhibit higher emissions. This fact indicates that acetylene can be a good fuel in our country. According to a report of Indian Bureau of Mines, we have a lot of calcium carbonate in our nature in the form of calcite rock. So, this may be a good procedure in the nearest future. Here is two probable diagram of engine where it is shown that how the acetylene can be used as a fuel. Then this presentation comes to an end. Thanks to my classmates of my semester who gave their strong effort to make this presentation. Thanks to our teachers who helped us giving useful advices and suitable suggestions in it. And also thanks to the audience present here to give us support. Thanks to all.
Thank you, Pritam. You presented acetylene as an alternative to our non-renewable resource coal. So it was a good depiction how to overcome the energy consumption problem and crisis. So it's a very good presented talk. We also had a talk in our chemistry department where the biofuels biofuels are also an alternative to this coal, non-renewable resources. So it's a very good talk. I proceed on to the next speaker, Obishikta Kundu, Semester 6 Zoology Honours. Her title of the talk is A Boon or Bane for the Environment. Obishikta, please proceed with your talk.
Thank you, ma'am. I will share the screen first. Good evening to Honorable Principal, ma'am, respected professors, and to everyone present here. I am Abhishikta Kundu from 6th Semester Zoology Department. So let's begin. Right now, we are in the middle of a pandemic. So I would like to discuss how this pandemic outbreak of COVID-19 is affecting our environment. COVID-19, a boon or bane for the environment? It is a valuable question, isn't it? The answer of which we will get to know at the end of presentation. Till then, please stay with me. First of all, we all know about coronavirus. It caused a fatal respiratory disease that led to a pandemic globally. It has not only affected us, but has affected the environment as well. There are some major positive impacts on the environment and some major negative impacts as well. Let's talk about the positive impacts of COVID-19 on environment first. Firstly, dwindling air pollution. Air pollution has reduced due to using lesser means of vehicular transport and shutting down of industries. As we can see on this image by NASA, the air pollution has decreased in Wuhan. The first three images shows us the higher concentration of NO2 level in air, but it gradually reduced. As we can see, the below three images during the pandemic when lockdown was implemented globally. Secondly, improvement of water quality. As water transport and activities of industries reduced, water pollution reduced as a result. As on these images of Venice canals, the first image is the image before the pandemic when the water was filthy, and the second image is the image during pandemic when the water has become clearer. Reduction in environmental noise due to traffic and industries have been minimalized. Decrease in energy and fuel demands due to shutting down of industries and transport. Better growth of vegetation and flourishing wildlife. On the second image, we can see a crowd of newly hatched sea turtles along Odisha coast, as there have been lesser human interference. Now let's focus on some concerning negative impacts on environment. The major concerning impact is increase in biomedical waste. What are biomedical wastes? Biomedical waste is defined as any waste generated during diagnosis, treatment, immunization of human beings or animals, or in research activity containing infectious material. These biomedical waste do not decompose. Production and disposal of surgical masks, PPE kits, gloves, syringes, safety goggles, etc. have been increased for the purpose of safety. But these are not disposed properly, ending up in landfills or polluting land and water. Even polypropylene used in N95 masks and tie weight for protective suits, gloves, etc. can release dioxin and toxic element in environment as well. In the images, we can notice how the masks are dumped irresponsibly, PPE kits are not disposed properly, and syringes used for injecting medicines and vaccinations are thrown away carelessly. Increase in inorganic waste. During this time, demand for plastic pack products have increased. Sanitizer bottles, soaps come in plastic packaging that increases the plastic count. Organic waste have also increased due to lack of export levels of food item. The image shows us wastage of vegetables. Water and soil get contaminated by the usage of soap, which makes the clean water a hard one. Alcohols and chlorine present in sanitizer, if mixed with water, can harm the flora and fauna of water bodies. Even biomedical wastes are dumped in the water foolishly. The corresponding image shows us the concerning fact that masks and other plastic waste are dumped in the water body. To stop such injustice against the environment, preventions must be taken to reduce this waste. For discarding the biomedical waste properly, it is important to know the composition so that its proper disposal can be ensured. Biomedical waste can be incinerated at 800 to 1200 degrees Celsius, which kills the pathogen and also reduces organic matter up to 90%. High temperature pyrolysis and medium temperature microwave technique are available to deal with biomedical waste. Wastewater should be treated before releasing it into water bodies. Usage of plastics to be reduced and more plastics to be recycled or disposed properly. Organic waste can be used for making fertilizers and composting. We have to adopt different strategies to sustain environmental improvement and achieve during the pandemic situation by incorporating different changes and adapting new normals. Some of the strategies are sustainable industrialization, like shifting to less energy intensive industry, use of cleaner fuel and technology, and strong energy efficient policies. To reduce emission, it is important for people to use public transport and bicycle for short distances. Sources like solar, wind, hydropower, geothermal heat, and biomass can be used instead of non-renewable energy like fossil fuels. Wastewater should be treated before discharging into water bodies, as I discussed on the earlier slide. Responsible international authorities like United Nations Environment should take effective role to prepare policies, conventions, and coordination of global leaders for implementation. To reduce carbon emission, we can take steps like saving electricity, composting from food waste, planting more trees for better oxygen availability. Ecological restoration and ecotourism should promote sustainable livelihood and biodiversity conservation. Waste generation to be reduced and promote recycling and reuse. With this, we come to conclusion. Is COVID-19 actually a boon or bane for the environment? The reduced pollution levels and replenished wildlife is definitely a silver lining amidst COVID-19. But it is a message to us and comes with a humanitarian cost, affecting both man and environment. The pandemic has taught us that changes can happen radically and spontaneously. So if we can frame the right policies and continue the positive aspects, we can achieve sustainable development. So COVID-19 is a boon or bane is completely dependent on us, how we react and act accordingly for a sustainable future. These are the references of information I used in my slides. Last but not the least, I would like to thank our respected principal ma'am and HOD and professors of zoology department for giving me this precious opportunity to showcase my point of view. With this, I end my presentation. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Abhishekta. You gave a very lucid talk. It has to be a joint venture at the personal level and at the larger level to fight this extreme pollution that is occurring due to this COVID-19, both in the form of biomedical wastes and in the form of what we have seen for the dead bodies being immersed in the river Ganges. So I hope that it will be a joint venture at the personal level and the government level. Now we proceed on to the next speaker, Raj Shaha, Semester 2, Chemistry Honours. The theme of his talk is Water Pollution and Conservation. Raj Shaha.
Can I audible?
Start presenting. Yeah, you are audible.
Well, good evening, my respected teachers and also my seniors and friends. Today I will discuss about water pollution and conservation. I am very happy to be a part of the seminar session organized by our college from celebrate World Environment Day. So at the first, water pollution and conservation, very important topic on the World Environment Day. So our responsibility, stop water pollution. So now we decide how to deal with water pollution and conservation. At first we need, what is the pollution, sir? Pollution is the introduction of harmful materials into the environment. These harmful materials are called pollutants. So there are various types of pollutions are there. So many types of pollutions. So mainly air pollution, water pollution, soil pollution, noise, radioactive light, visual and thermal pollution such. So now we need to know what the global water distribution, what is the total 100% water is salt. This is a shocking information, and the 3% water is fresh, and the 3% water is the 2% of waste in the frozen and 1% available to use by animals. Among the 1% is the 0.44% is used by industry, 0.47% is used by agriculture, and 0.09% available for us to use. So now, focus our today's main topic is water pollution. We all know that water pollution, as another name is aquatic pollution, is the contamination of water bodies usually as a result of human activity. So include some example is lakes, rivers, oceans, aquifers and groundwater. Okay. And the important thing, what is the causes of water pollution? So mainly, these types of water pollutions are very much causes the importance. So first, sewage and wastewater. It's the most harmful and main cause of water pollution. The waste from households, factories and agricultural land get discharged into rivers or lakes. These harmful chemicals out of the waste can damage our aquatic life. Dumping. Most water bodies get converted into dumping grounds and nearby localities, and the cause a huge problem because the dump contains everything from plastic, aluminium, glass and many etc. Oil pollution. This is the most important and most prestigious and harmful effect on water pollution is oil pollution. One of the worst type of water pollution is oil pollution. This is because the oil spills from tankers and ships tend to create a thick layer above the water, seas and ocean. Now focus on acid rain. Acid rain is the natural problem. Even though acid rains may seem like a natural problem, but it's wise to note that acid rains are caused due to acidic particles in the air. And then now, agriculture, UV ray caused by global warming, radioactive waste and industrial waste. Now, impact of water pollution on the ecosystem. So, mainly diseases and ruination of ecosystem, eutrophication and adverse impact on the food chain. So, which type of diseases are there? Not just the aquatic life, even when the humans end up drinking polluted water, is the various types of illness like hepatitis, cholera, typhoid and many other waterborne discharge. Ruination of the ecosystem. Our ecosystem is extremely fragile. Even a simple change can feed ecosystem to respect the impact of environment. Now focus eutrophication. The chemicals available in the water body promote the growth of algae. This algae end up formation the thick layer over the pond and lakes. The bacteria present on the water tend to feed on algae, causing the amount of oxygen in the water to decrease. Now we focus how to prevent. This is the main topic with prevention with water pollution. Don't dump. Dumping is the most harmful. We know that the previous slides. So, but we are polluted day by day and so on source of water. Clean and maintain septic system properly. Follow all water laws and regulations given out by our government. Dispose the pesticides and chemicals properly. Never pour cooking fats and oil down the sink. Refrain from using bleach while washing at home. Now, we know that at first, what is importance of water? The water helps breathing, helps the body absorb nutrients, makes up 83% of your blood, removes waste, and helps carry oxygen to your cells. And the most important uses of water is protect your vital organ. So life on earth depends primarily on the most sophisticated chemical reaction performed by our mother nature called photosynthesis. We know that photosynthesis reaction is also included by carbon dioxide and water. So photosynthesis converts into chemical energy and then store the chemical energy. Up to 70% of human adult body is water. So what is water
then most importantly think what is the how we conserve the water. Sorry, water conservation has turned into an essential practice in every part of the world. Even in regions where water appears to be enough, it is the most practical and environment-friendly approach to listen our need to water. So now, water conservation is mainly important. So there are many lines out there. First, respect water and respect life. Pay for water services to our government and environmental action and don't waste water. So conserve water or conserve life. Now, we can also know that the best process of water conservation is water harvesting. It means capturing rain where it falls or capturing the turn of your village or town and taking measures to keep the water clean by not allowing polluting activities to take places and catchment. The process is given below. Know that the research is many reports have openly claimed that year 2025, two-thirds of the world will face water shortage. The only way to offend the coming generation to cope the line and the following are right water conservation practices. So, advantages of water conservation: reduce the need to costly water supply and new to wastewater treatment facilities. Rivers and lakes will remain clean. Protect drinking water sources and many types of method to purifying sewage water. First, RBC help, and second, the central process. Minimize water pollution and health risk. This is the advantages of water conservation. So please save water. Thank you for all your kind attention. I also acknowledge my friend Tirtha Kumar Pal and Somodip Bhoumik for preparing this presentation. I am also grateful to my teachers in the department for their constant support. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Raj. It was a very good presentation. Life is water. So it was a very good topic to choose also. Now we invite our next speaker, Ama Maheshwari Muhuri, Semester 4 IFF Honours. Our topic is man, friend or foe environment. Ama Maheshwari Muhuri, please start.
Am I audible now clearly?
Yes, yes. Raj, please unmute yourself.
Good evening, my respected teachers and all other listeners present in this webinar. Today I am going to discuss on a topic related to environment, man, friend or foe to environment. So what does environment mean? Environment is the surroundings in which we live and it includes the living and non-living things. Now what role environment plays? Environment has basically four functions: provisioning services, regulating services, supporting services, and cultural services. Next is discuss the relationship between environment and human. From this graph, this is clear that there exists a reciprocal relationship between ecosystem and human. As the super creator of the Almighty, we have more responsibility to support our environment as a friend. But whether we are doing this or not, the simple answer is not, and which has led thus to raise several environmental issues. And the major environmental issues are like pollution, global warming and climate change, melting of polar ice caps, ozone layer depletion, deforestation, natural resource depletion, loss of biodiversity, and ocean acidification. As most of us have basic idea about the causes of these major environmental issues, so in this presentation, I have basically tried to represent the trend. The first is air pollution, and these are the major sources of air pollution. And in this slide, you can see that air pollution as a silently killer has taken a toll of 7 million deaths every year. And in the Southeast Asia region, where our country, India, is a part, here also about 2 million death rates has been reported due to air pollution every year. And in this graphical presentation, you can see that India has ranked third among world's most polluted countries. And the most serious issue of concern is that 13 out of 20 polluted cities of the world are in India. Next is water pollution. And the major causes of water pollution are industrial waste, marine dumping, mining, burning of fossil fuels, pesticides, and oil spills. This is a pictorial presentation of world water pollution status. And here you can see that red and deep maroon colored region are showing that they are highly affected from water pollution. And you can see the major parts of India is also suffering from high risk of water pollution. Now, next topic is global warming, which is increase in mean temperature of Earth. And it has been reported by NASA that global temperature is increasing at the rate of 0.2 degrees Celsius per decade, and 2020 tying with 2016 has been recorded as the warmest. Now, this slide is representing the impact of climate change in India. The climate change is a related issue of global warming. And here you can see that the deep violet region have faced the maximum temperature enhancement. The so far enlisted consequences of climate change in India, the warmer season, increased annual rainfall, and incidence of intense cyclonic activity, rising of sea level, and increased incidence of flood and drought. Now, this is a graphical presentation of melting rate of polar ice caps in Arctic and Antarctic region. A six-fold increase in polar ice cap has been reported by NASA from 1995 to 2020. And this is a prediction model by NASA in Antarctic region, and they have predicted that in 2050 the polar ice thickness will be very low, and this white area, the decrease of white area, indicates that there are present ice of with reduced thickness. With melting of ice, the sea level is gradually rising, and global mean sea level has risen about 21 to 24 centimeters since 1880. With about one third of that coming in just the last 2.5 decades. So this is a pictorial presentation of ozone layer depletion in Antarctic region by NASA. There you can see that in 1979, there no ozone hole was reported. And from 1982, a ozone hole, it started to appear prominently and gradually increased. And you can see that in 10-year span, there a ozone hole was present in 1989, 1999 and 2009, but in 2019 the ozone hole was reduced. That's a sign of relief for us, maybe. But in Arctic region, there was no ozone hole was reported till 23rd March 2019, but a rare ozone hole was reported in 2020 in Arctic region. Now, this is a graphical presentation of deforestation rate in global and India, and both cases we can see that the deforestation rate is gradually increasing. Now, this is a graphical presentation of utilization of natural resource depletion, and there we can see that the red line is gradually increasing, and which indicates that we are using our natural resources at in high rate with time. Next topic is loss of biodiversity. This is a graphical presentation of conservation status of global species, and you can see that about 36% species of worldwide are now threatened, and the number of endangered species is rising with time. And so now, what about India? We all know that India is one among the 17 megadiverse countries with 4 biodiversity hotspots, and right now we are also facing the problem of biodiversity loss, and this also alarming us on continued basis. The problem of biodiversity loss is coming in newspaper, and the left topmost news has just published just 3 days ago. And now this slide is representing that how our ocean is being acidified. And due to ocean acidification, the carbonate ions become unavailable to the corals and the calcareous creatures, and which will lead them to their extinction. Now, what to do to save our environment? and what should be our responsibility towards our environment. So there are some following solutions which we can follow: reduce, reuse, recycle, proper waste management, tree plantation, save water, reduction of carbon footprint, say no to plastic, and which is very, very important is mass awareness. There are some environment movements occurred earlier in India, and these four are recent activities of India. And the first, Safe Dehing Patkai, is a very recent activity of India, and the Dehing Patkai is regarded as the Amazon of East. There are some renowned environment activists of India, and there are some less known faces like Jadav Pai, Salumarada Thimaka, Tulsi Gowda, Marimuthu Yoganathan, and there are some young environmentalists, Lissi Priya from Manipur, India, and Greta Thunberg, whom we all know. And there are some eco-friendly approaches from different parts of India, which we can also think. And I am thankful to Sandeepan sir and to my team for helping me in guiding and making this presentation. And now I would like to throw a question to you all: whether we will continue to destroy our environment or will support our environment as a friend. Decision is ours, and whether to keep our environment for a better living place or to make it a hell for our future generation. Now, thank you.
Thank you very much, Avamneshwari. You have covered a large aspect of the various aspects of the environment and its solutions in a very lucid way. So, mention to all our young environmentalists who are activists, and it is a great thing that you have shown the less known names also, those who are fighting to save our environment. Thank you so much for your speech. Now I welcome our next speaker, Angona Shengupto, Semester 2 Botany PG. Topic of speech is Changing the Plastic World Through Ecosystem Restoration. Please, Angona, come with your.
Ma'am, am I audible?
Yes, you're audible.
Okay, ma'am. Good evening to my respected teachers, seniors, and my dear friends. This year, UN has declared ecosystem restoration as the theme for World Environment Day celebration. So my topic is Changing the Plastic World Through Ecosystem Restoration. Today, we are talking about ecosystem restoration because it helps us to restore whatever has been destroyed by active participation of human beings. And why do we need to restore? Because if we look at this picture, these activities like deforestation, removal of forest for agriculture, overgrazing, urbanization, they can lead to desertification. But that's not the end of the story. We can undo this. We can recover this area through soil management, through plantation, and we can get back our ecosystem, which provides us with food, livelihood, etc. That is why we need to conserve our ecosystem, as it gives us four services: regulating service like soil, nutrient management, supporting service like nutrient cycle, provisioning service like food, fiber, cultural service like recreation and ecotourism. One of the main areas where we need to use ecosystem restoration is that plastic pollution, and these are different kinds of plastic. We cannot think of life without plastic. These different, the different products made of plastic. Plastic is a polymer it is non-degradable over a period of time. Through sun's effect, it breaks down into smaller particles. Both in water and land, and it enters the ecosystem. So if we look at water ecosystem, these are the different kinds of waste. These are taken by animals, and let's look at a few examples. If we look at birds, they ingest plastic, which results in biomagnification. It results in death of young one. It results in species loss. If we look at aquatic animals, especially turtles, they love jellyfish, which look very much like polybags, and they ingest it, which results in bursting of their internal organs and death, and hence species loss. If we look at humans, ourselves, or fishes, how biomagnification of plastic waste in their food chain occurs, and eventually the fish comes to comes out, and when we humans take it, we have different kinds of issues. With our immune system, it causes cancer, etc. Even burning of plastic waste releases dioxins, which causes cancer and also affects our immune system. In this COVID situation, we can very well understand if our immune system is poor, we will not be able to fight this battle. Hence, what can we do, or how can we rectify this? Let's look at the three R's, that is reduce, reuse, and recycle. We should follow these steps in order to reduce plastic pollution. And for our foremost duty, or first, we should always try to reduce plastic waste. And then after that, we should think about reuse and recycling. But it does not mean that we will not give importance to reuse and recycle process. Now let us look at some of the restoration procedures like plasma pyrolysis technology, which is very environment friendly, and it can recycle plastic waste. Plasma pyrolysis or plasma gasification is a waste treatment technology that gasifies matter in an oxygen-starved environment to decompose waste material into its basic molecular structure. We can also go for liquid plastic, where we use which we use for making durable roads. We can also go for making fuel from plastic waste, thereby conserving the ecosystem. And eventually, each one of us can reduce plastic. We can carry our own bags. We can use less of disposable plastic, one-time plastic. We should revive our use of jute, even in West Bengal. The jute industry could be revived, and each one of us, we can do this. And we can also use biodegradable plastics, which are derived from renewable biomass sources, and they degrade within a few years. Let's pledge to have a better tomorrow by making this world plastic free or using minimum plastic. Thank you. I have taken this information from NET. And at the end, I would like to thank my classmates, Sriyoshi and Moina, for contributing substantially to this presentation. And I also would like to thank the teachers of Botany Department for helping me. Thank you.
Thank you, Angona. for choosing such an important topic. It is our motto, we have to say no to plastic. Because it has to be a revolution. Because it is being pledged, again we are using plastics. So I hope we continue our pledge. Now I invite our last speaker, Navratra, Semester 2, English Honours, whose topic is Divinity of Environment. Please, Navratra, you proceed with your talk.
Am I audible, ma'am?
Yes.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It's a pleasure to be here today. First of all, I would like to wish you a very good evening to one and all present here today in the seminar. Is my screen visible?
Yes.
Okay. So before I start speaking on my today's topic, that is Divinity of Environment, I would like to ask a question from all of you. You don't need to give me the answer. I just want you to think about it once. And the question is in front of you. Just count how many times you have planted a tree, and also count how many times you have worshipped a tree or used a tree in worshipping, and compare both. I repeat, just count how many times you have planted a tree, and also count how many times you have worshipped a tree and used a tree in worshipping, and compare both. Okay, so I will elaborate this point later on. Before that, let us start. So what is divinity of environment? Everything which is created by the Almighty is divine. I want to give a special emphasis on this word. Everything which is created by the God, be it us, the human beings, the plants, the animals, the water bodies, and the mountains, all these are called divine creations. And the Almighty not only have created this beautiful world, this beautiful environment, but also have suggested us ways of using and protecting these divine creations through different holy books. All the religions agree that the nature is an act of divinity and should be treated as such. Okay, in the book of Leviticus, that is a book of Christianity, which consists of God's speeches to Moses, it is written, "If you walk in my statutes and observe my commandments and do them, then I will give you your rains in their season, and the land shall yield its increase, and the trees of the field shall yield their fruits." This is so much related to the protection of our environment, that the God is saying that if we follow the laws made by Him, then in return He will also help us, the human beings, to survive on this earth. Not even this. We all are very much aware of the importance of palm tree and the most famous, the evergreen Christmas tree in Christianity. All these things directly or indirectly somehow shows the importance of trees. Now, if we shift our discussion towards Sikhism, we got to know that in the book of Japji Sahib, Guru Nanak Dev Ji said, "Pavan Guru Pani Pita Mata Dharat Mahat Divas Rat Dui Dai Daya Khelai Sakal Jagat," which means wind is the teacher, water is the father, and earth is the great mother. Day and night are the two kind nurtures, and this whole world plays under them. How beautifully and precisely Guru Nanak Dev Ji have stated the importance of nature for human beings. In Islam, Abdul Baha states that let us look at the beauty in diversity, the beauty of harmony, and learn a lesson from the vegetable creation. It is just the diversity and variety that constitutes its charm. Each flower, each tree, each fruit, beside being beautiful in itself, brings out by contrast the qualities of the others and shows to advantage the special loveliness of each and all. Also, it is said that jo shakhs darkaton ko kaatta hai, wo maloon hai. That is, cutting the trees is a very big sin, sin in Islamic dharma. In the Buddhist connections, the reflection on environment, the quote is, As a bee, without harming the blossom, its color, its fragrance, takes its nectar and flies away, so should the sage go through a village. That is, just like animals take the advantages of nature without harming it, we should also do it in the same way. And of course, the last but not the least, Hinduism. Hinduism is a religion deeply rooted in nature. The sacred texts, that is the Vedas, the Upanishads, Srimad Bhagavad Gita, the epics, has many references of divinity related to nature, such as rivers, mountains, trees, animals, and the earth. The Shastras in Hinduism have mentioned the importance of peepal tree, banana tree, banyan tree, neem tree, tulsi plant, even the desertic plant khejri has been worshipped. We also know about animals, the cow, of course, Go Mata, the bull, Nandi of Lord Shiva, the serpent, Vasuki, the tiger or the lion of Goddess Durga, the elephant, Iravat of Lord Indra, even the birds, Garudadev, the owl of Goddess Lakshmi, and there are lots and lots of birds, animals and plants. And the holy rivers, Ganga, Jamuna, Saraswati, the mountains like Kailash. And of course, if we talk about Lord Shiva, then all the elements of nature will come into the scene. So, these are some examples from different religions which I loved reading and sharing with all of you. Well, I know there is nothing new in all these religious aspects. We all have heard about these things from the very beginning of our lives. Remember, I asked you to think about a question in the very beginning of my speech. That is, count the times we have planted a tree and count the times we have worshipped one, which is more. And I am very much sure that you people have the same answer which I have, that we worshipped or used a tree more times than planting one. So the very next question which comes in our mind is that why? Why God have made and defined all these elements of nature to be so divine? And are these elements only limited within the religions? And the answer is a very big no. Our environment is not only limited within our own religions or some other religion, but the Almighty have defined it to be divine because He wants us to understand that for the survival of human life and for this world to keep on moving on the right track, our environment is playing a vital and very important role. Let us not go so far. Let us take the example of this pandemic situation only. Just before 15 to 20 days, the corona patients were suffering from the huge crisis of oxygen. And what day people did then? They suddenly got to know about the importance of trees, and they started planting trees for clean air and proper oxygen and all around their houses. I have read lots and lots of news about it. And what I could conclude from this is that if we, the so-called minded creatures, cannot understand the direct sayings of Almighty, He has the power to make us understand the importance of our environment in a different way. I just want to end my speech today by saying that this is the high time to take the responsibility of all the droughts, the floods, global warming, cyclones, pandemic, to understand. This is the time to understand that we are sitting in the lap of nature, and we need to reciprocate the love which our Mother Earth is giving to us. It is the time to understand the divinity of environment without being a part of superstitions. Thank you so much for your patient listening. I, Navratra, second semester student of English department, want to wish you have a nice day.
Thank you so much, Navratra. You have spoken a very important aspect and a very different aspect in sense, because it is only our harmonious coexistence with our ecosystem that we can survive. Irrespective of whatever religion, planting a tree always gives us solace, and really all the natural phenomenon, they have to be in a harmonious balance. So anything which is damaging, which is putting a break in this cycle, will of course disbalance this total ecosystem. So it is utmost necessary that we go on saving our environment, stopping the environmental pollutions and proceed to for the future generation, so that we can have a very safe environment. So by so we come to the end of the session today. Will a vote of thanks be given by any of our SAP members? Will it be given by the customary vote of thanks? Will it be given by any of our SAP members? Hello?
Hello, Manushide?
Yes, Vishwarupa has come. Okay.
Ask Navarat, please stop present.
Yeah, I was in fact just writing to congratulate all the presenters that it was very well researched. Each presentation was so well researched, so well articulated. It was a thorough pleasure to listen to all of you, and so encouraging to see you all go deeper into understanding how we can save our environment. And I'm sure in coming days, online or offline, all of us together, we can make a change, even if it is a small change, but we will make some changes. Maybe we will look into calculating our ecological footprint. Each one of us, we could do something on that area. Every student, every teacher, we will calculate our ecological footprint. We'll see how much we are contributing to the negative aspects of the environment. And from there, from our homes, from our colleges, from our classrooms, we will start the change of how we can positively undo whatever has been, whatever wrong we have done to the environment. And the easiest way to undo is to plant a tree, which I'm sure all of you have started at home, because this year, NSS Eco Club, all of us, we have encouraged our students to plant at home. Even if you are planting a small pot, do not think it unworthy, because the amount of oxygen it is giving is worth in millions. This COVID situation has already shown us that how important our oxygen is to us. And a green environment is a thing of pleasure. Also, it gives us all our food, livelihood, oxygen, etc. So please be rooted to this research, to this theme that man and his environment, he should impact his environment positively, not negatively. Thank you all the students. You have done wonderful. Congratulations to all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So we end the session.
Yes, I think it is time that we should end the session. I would like to thank from my side all the participants. They have presented wonderfully. I'm just, speechless. They have covered such a different areas, and they have presented so nicely. We will hope to continue this kind of seminars and webinars in future also. So have a good day and good evening to everybody. I'm ending this session right now. Thank you.